Hunk's past is one so clouded in mystery, we know next to nothing about his past, even with his real name being unknown. The earliest record we have of Hunk was during his training at the Rockford Island facility in 1996, and over the next 2 years, Hunk would go on a large amount of missions, with many of them leaving himself the only survivor. This pattern would make him infamous among the other Umbrella Security Service agents, earning him the nickname Mr. Death. In fact, his survival rate for operations was rivaled only by one other operative, Sergeant Nikolai Ginoviev of the UBCS. During these 2 years, Hunk would also train another USS operative named Vector, training him in martial arts, with Vector's skill in the area eventually coming to rival his own. The next known incident was on September 15th, 1998, where Hunk would take command of a team to bring in Dr. William Birkin, as well as his G-Virus, as the company had gained proof that the doctor was in contact with the US military. While his orders were to bring in the doctor alive, William would pull a gun on the team, resulting in him being gunned down by one of Hunk's men. The team would then take the virus samples and prepare to leave, but William had survived and injected himself with the virus sample he had kept on himself, and would immediately mutate, killing Hunk's team once again, leaving Hunk the sole survivor. He would then fight his way through the infected Raccoon City sewers and police station, eventually getting extracted on September 30th, thanks to a pilot who had wanted to meet him due to his reputation. After returning to Umbrella with a sample, Hunk would be briefly assigned to Rockford Island, but he would either be reassigned before or escape its infection. After this, we know absolutely nothing up until the fall of Umbrella, where, in the following years, Hunk would become a legendary mercenary. Nikolai Ginoviev was born in Moscow during the year 1963. Little is known about his upbringing up until he would turn 18, where he would either join or be conscripted into the military, eventually rising through the ranks, eventually becoming a Spetsnaz sergeant. He would continue to serve until the Union's collapse in 1991. After this, he would be approached by an old friend, Sergei Vladimir, who is now an executive at the pharmaceutical and bioweapons development company known as Umbrella, and Sergei would offer Nikolai the opportunity to serve as a mercenary for the company. During his employment of Umbrella, Nikolai would gain Sergei's trust, eventually becoming a supervisor reporting directly to him, though officially he would only have the rank of sergeant. During his service to Umbrella, he would mostly be given assignments involving evidence collection and destruction. Many of the missions he took part in had an unusually high death rate for him, with only Nikolai surviving many of them. His survival rate was nearly unmatched, save for one operative, the USS agent Hunk. However, despite his years working for Umbrella, it was clear that he had no true loyalty to the company, often refusing promotions in favor of money, and only seemed to work for Umbrella because he truly enjoyed fighting and wanted to show off his abilities. In September 1998, a mission to bring in Dr. William Birkin as well as an experimental virus would go wrong, resulting in a T-virus outbreak, which quickly overtook Raccoon City. As a result, on September 26th, Nikolai would be deployed under Mikhail Viktor in order to aid civilians and combat the infected. However, unknown to his squad, Nikolai's true mission was to monitor and record effectiveness against trained soldiers. During his 3-day deployment, Nikolai would be receiving additional orders, such as eliminating a scientist who Umbrella suspected was going to betray the company, and setting the USS Delta Squad up against BOWs. After these missions, he would regroup with his squad, and due to Mikhail's injuries, would take command, just as Corporal Carlos Olivero would return, bringing Raccoon City STARS officer Jill Valentine with him. However, Jill was being tracked by an experimental tyrant BOW, which had quickly found her and resulted in Mikhail's death. It was shortly after this that Nikolai would be given his final orders to ensure that none of his fellow UBCS members survived the operation, and he would begin killing them and would have a second run-in with Delta Squad. After this battle, which Nikolai had been forced to flee from, he would receive instructions to escape the city as the US government had launched a nuke and made his way to a water treatment plant where he would find himself a helicopter and escape, but not before encountering Jill and Carlos one last time before escaping the city and reporting to Sergei. After this event, Nikolai would disappear without so much as a rumor to his whereabouts during or after the fall of Umbrella. Hey everyone, I'm Ray92, and today I will be bringing my first Resident Evil matchup, where I'll be pitting fan-favorite USS agent Hunk up against the lesser-known but just as dangerous UBCS supervisor Nikolai Ginoviev. Now, considering there isn't too much to go off of their original appearances, I will be combining multiple versions of these characters. For Hunk, I will be combining his appearances from Resident Evil 2 and its remake, his appearances in the various mercenary and raid modes from several games, and finally, his appearance in Operation Raccoon City in its online mode. Now, for Nikolai, due to changes made in the Resident Evil 3 remake, I will be sticking strictly to the original timeline, combining his appearances from Resident Evil 3, Resident Evil Outbreak, and again, Resident Evil Operation Raccoon City in its online mode. Now, with everything cleared up, let's get started. During the events of Resident Evil 2, Hunk is a human male and would likely be somewhere in his mid to late 30s. Now, while there's no official statement on his height, by comparing his in-game model to that of Leon, who is 5 feet 11 inches tall, we can see that he's about an inch or two shorter, putting him at roughly 5 feet 9 inches and likely weighing around 190 pounds. As a soldier, Hunk has conditioned himself to be in excellent physical condition, being able to perform various combat and operation scenarios. His best showing of physical strength is his ability to effortlessly snap the neck of a human. Now, without getting too far into the details, the way Hunk does this is probably the most difficult and impractical way to snap someone's neck there is, with the correct way to do so already needing a damn good amount of strength. On top of that, it's actually far less likely that doing this will actually result in a kill. So the fact that Hunk can easily do so and reliably kill his opponent with this method implies a near superhuman amount of strength. Now, he has no notable feats or really anything to suggest that his speed would be anything out of the ordinary, but at the same time, due to him being a trained soldier with years of experience in special operations under his belt, along with how he's developed his strength, would convince me that to put him well above an average man when it comes to this area. His stamina would need to be high as well, as he single-handedly fought off infected for 2 weeks with no backup until his extraction on September 30th. I'd put his durabilities at similar levels to his strength, thanks to him being able to survive a hit with a metal pipe by G1 Birkin. By this point in his mutation, Birkin had already achieved the strength necessary to kill a man in only a few blows, and considering his G2 form had enough strength to one-shot a tyrant, it's not too much of a stretch to think that the G1 could go head-to-head with one. During the events of Resident Evil 3, Nikolai was a 35-year-old human male standing at 6 feet 2 inches tall and weighed 225 pounds. Unfortunately, there are very few direct examples of Nikolai in combat, and as such, I don't have enough to get into most of the specific of his physical abilities. But it can be assumed that due to his years of military and combat service, he would need to at least be in excellent physical condition in order to carry out his various missions and tasks for the company. One area we do have a good feat for is his durability, where after shooting one of his fellow UBCS operatives, the injured man pulled up into his grenade, and along with being in close proximity to an exploding frag grenade, Nikolai was blown out of a fourth story window and was immediately back up and rigged the building to explode. As soldiers, both Hunk and Nikolai would have conditioned themselves to perform in a multitude of combat situations. To be up front, Nikolai is at a disadvantage here due to not having as many outright feats as Hunk, and thus less information to go off of. While I have no doubt Nikolai would have the strength to compete with the majority of characters, or even someone like Chris up until the events of Code Veronica, Hunk simply has near superhuman strength, so he really can't compare. Speed is impossible to compare due to lack of feats, and as such, I'll be considering these two equals. While we have no concrete proof of Nikolai's stamina limit, Hunk's solitary's 2-week stay in Raccoon City while needing to deal with hordes of bioweapons is so far above a 3-day stay with backup, I'm willing to give it to Hunk anyway. Nikolai actually has a pretty strong lead on the durability advantage, as getting thrown out of a 4th-story window on top of surviving a close-range explosive and then walking it off like it was nothing trumps only getting knocked out by the rough equivalent of a T-103. Not to mention, Nikolai had much less protective equipment than Hunk. However, that just isn't enough to put him above Hunk, as speaking in a purely physical sense, not only can Hunk hit harder, but he can outlast and tank more damage than Nikolai can deal out on his own. And it is for these reasons that I will give Hunk the edge in physical abilities. Hunk will be bringing 3 primary weapons into this engagement, all from his appearance in the Resident Evil 2 remake. His primary weapon will be an MP5 machine gun, which fires 9mm bullets, has a clip size of 32 bullets, has a fire rate of roughly 800 rounds a minute, and has an effective firing range of 650 feet. His sidearm will be his USP9 handgun. This weapon fires 9mm bullets, has a modified clip size of 16 bullets, and has an effective firing range of 160 feet. His final weapon will be a standard issue US military combat knife measuring about 8 inches in total length. I will also be granting him his hidden blades, which he has hidden in his boots and along his forearms, 3 flashbangs, and finally a cloaking device which he used in the Resident Evil Operation Raccoon City online mode. This cloak lasts roughly 30 seconds, however it will disappear on its own if he fires a weapon or comes into physical contact with anyone. It needs about 2 minutes to recharge before it can be used again. His protective gear has thankfully remained fairly consistent throughout all his appearances, sporting a helmet, gas mask, tactical vest, and finally elbow and knee pads. Nikolai will be bringing 3 weapons into this engagement. His primary weapon, which he used in both Outbreak and Operation Raccoon City, will be an HMK PSG-1, a sniper rifle. This weapon has an effective firing range of nearly 3,000 feet, fires 55mm bullets, and has an average clip size of 5 bullets. For sidearm, I'll be granting him a Sig Sauer P226, which was his sidearm from the game Operation Raccoon City. This fires 9mm bullets, has a clip size of 15 bullets, has an effective firing range of about 160 feet. His third and final weapon is a standard issue US military combat knife measuring roughly about 8 inches in total length. I will also be granting him 3 frag grenades and a pair of proximity mines, again from the game Operation Raccoon City. Going over his non-weapon equipment, his protective gear is shockingly minimal, wearing only a tactical bulletproof vest and knee pads for armor. Thanks to the addition of Hunk's experimental cloaking device and hidden blades, this is a bit more complicated than it would seem, but when you get down to it, there is a clear winner in this area. Who holds the advantage with their primary weapons is 100% dependent on the range they're fighting at. At long range, Nikolai would have the advantage with his sniper rifle, and at mid to close range encounters, Hunk's submachine gun would give him the advantage. However, Nikolai would be the better choice overall, as Hunk will need to get in close in order to have any hope of landing a kill shot. Meanwhile, Nikolai would be capable of taking Hunk out the moment he spots him. Their sidearms are practically the same weapon, with the only real difference being that Hunk's USP-9 holds one more bullet than Nikolai's Sig Sauer P226. Their knives are both standard-issue American Army-issue combat knives and are identical. I actually believe their grenades would counter each other out. Now, while Nikolai's frag grenades are obviously the more dangerous of the two, Hunk's use of his flashbang could be the deciding factor in a close-range encounter, making them just as deadly. Hunk's cloak would be the perfect tool for getting in close to Nikolai, if not for its short duration and long recharge time. While Hunk would be able to get in relatively close, it will eventually run out of charge, and he will be forced to take cover. And when that happens, he will be a sitting duck, unable to make a move due to the threat of Nikolai's sniper, and even worse, at closer ranges, his grenades, making it a better tool for assassination rather than a one-on-one encounter between soldiers. That, and it isn't a perfect close, as the closer you get, as it's actually much closer to the Predator's active camouflage, being visible if you look hard enough, and giving off some sort of electrical mist, meaning it can be spotted when first activated. Hunk has the armor advantage, with his standard gear protecting much more than Nikolai's minimalist style. However, I should note that it wouldn't do any good against one of Nikolai's explosives. While Hunk's cloak would be a great in a one-on-one encounter with any other kind of opponent, its timer and recharge time make it impractical against a sniper, as he will need to move from cover to cover and then wait for his cloak to recharge, giving Nikolai plenty of opportunity to think of a strategy to get around this, which means all Nikolai would need to do to counter this is take shots at the right moment to force Hunk into a close enough for him to throw down a frag grenade, forcing Hunk into the open for a kill shot. However, while Hunk's cloak would be something of a double-edged sword at first, if used properly during a close-range encounter, it would be invaluable. That, on top of his better armor, would put him in a better position overall against Nikolai. And it is for these reasons that I give Hunk the edge in weapons and equipment. Hunk's approach to combat and missions in general was to be quick and efficient. He's cold, ruthless, and willing to eliminate anyone between him and his goal. While there's no concrete evidence of his tactics in combat from his equipment and mission history, we can make a few assumptions. His gear seems to suggest he prefers engagements from a mid to close range, cloak and flashbang suggesting that fighting would be a last resort in favor of escaping his enemy's pursuit. His only known mission was that of the arrest of William Birkin, which was meant to be a quick in-and-out extraction with minimal casualties. All this combined suggests to me that Hunk specialized in stealth operations where combat was seen as a last resort, such as extraction or assassination scenarios. Just to clarify, that is not to say that he would be bad in a direct combat scenario, as surviving 2 weeks in an ongoing T-virus outbreak proves that he is more than capable in these situations. While we don't get many first-hand examples of Hunk's hand-to-hand capabilities, or even what martial arts he uses, there are a few second-hand examples that we can use to get an idea of his skill level. First up, we know that after the use of bioweapons became common practice among terrorist organizations, Hunk developed his own unique fighting style known as Close Quarters Quarantine Battle Zone, which was made to quickly and efficiently kill BOWs that could rip a person apart. The other is that he played a large role in training fellow USS member Vector, who was easily capable of killing trained UBCS mercenaries and fought evenly with United States Special Forces members. As a member of Spetsnaz during the Cold War, Nikolai would have primarily been trained in the art of assassination and espionage, with his UBCS training only adding to his already impressive array of skills, such as demolition, marksmanship, and hand-to-hand combat, just to name a few. Such a large array of skills would imply that he's a highly adaptable combatant capable of switching tactics on the fly. While Nikolai is capable in a head-to-head engagement, he is more comfortable aiming down at his enemies with a sniper rifle, throwing explosives down at anyone too close for his liking. He's also shown a fondness for explosives, often setting up traps to anyone going where he doesn't want them to. One aspect of his personality which won't be doing him any favors in this fight is his habit of talking down to his enemies before securing a kill, which could easily bite him in the ass against the wrong opponent. While we don't have any examples of his skill in hand-to-hand combat, we do know that he has a large amount of skill in this area, as we know he has trained for years to use a few martial arts during his time, serving both the Soviet military and the UBCS, such as Judo, Jiu-Jitsu, and finally, Sistema, which, for example, was used by Leon during his fights with Jack Krauser and Chris Redfield. Both of these umbrella agents are tailored towards stealth and assassination, but with both having their own ways of engaging head-to-head combat. For Hunk, it's finding the quickest way to deal with his opponent, and then using that method to take them out and then continue on his mission. For Nikolai, he takes a slightly more indirect approach, as shown in both his encounters with the USS Delta team, as in all of his engagements with them, he lured them into an area where he had set up traps and was complete control over the situation. On paper, I'd say Nikolai's tactics would be more effective, letting him keep control of the fight, even against a more skilled opponent. So the question here is, can Nikolai use this strategy against Hunk? And in my opinion, he would have absolutely no issue with this. While this would be impossible for a head-to-head fight from the very start, that just isn't how Nikolai operates. Due to him being a sniper, the second he sees Hunk, he's going to find a good position to aim, bunker down, and keep shooting at Hunk until he either gets a kill shot or is forced to move. And once that happened, all he would need to do would be to set up one room to explode, lure Hunk into said room, and then toss in a grenade to finish the job. And thanks to the distance Hunk is going to need to clear, Nikolai would have more than enough time to set this up. Hand-to-hand combat clearly goes to Hunk. As while I'm sure Nikolai's skill in this area are at the very least competent, Hunk was pretty much unmatched among Umbrella soldiers, save for one man, who Hunk himself had a large part in training. However, considering Nikolai would be aware of Hunk's reputation, I don't feel he'd be rushing in to have a knife fight unless forced to, or as a way to buy more time. What puts Nikolai overall above Hunk for me is his specialty in area control and adaptability, giving him the perfect skill set to adapt and counter to Hunk's comparatively simple combat style. And it's for these reasons that I give Nikolai the edge in combat skills and tactics. Let's set up this fight. Let's say that it takes place during the Rockford Island T. Veronica virus outbreak, and that Nikolai has been hired by the same organization that hired Wesker in order to eliminate USS presence on the island, while Hunk has been assigned to the island for protection, and the two encounter each other this way. I see this fight playing out in two stages, with the first stage being standard for a sniper encounter, where Nikolai will shoot down at Hunk while he moves from cover to cover to get in close, and the second stage being a cat and mouse game like Leon's final battle with Krauser, with Hunk playing the role of Leon and Nikolai playing Krauser's part. Nikolai would be the first to see Hunk, either spotting him through his scope or from a distance, but either way, he would quickly make his way to a nearby building, and after finding a comfortable position, he would take a shot, narrowly missing Hunk, who would immediately dive for cover and grab his radio, and would attempt to defuse the situation, giving his name and unit number in order to clear up what he believes to be a case of mistaken identity. Nikolai receives this transmission and is pleasantly surprised to hear that it's the infamous Hunk. Knowing he won't get another opportunity and letting his ego get the better of him, he answers his own radio and informs Hunk that he's a mercenary and has actually been ordered to wipe out Umbrella forces on the island. Hunk is understandably confused as to why Nikolai would tell him this and asks him why. Why Nikolai is telling him this, only to get the response,
"Because I'd like a challenge, Mr. Death. These mindless zombies and simple mercenaries are too easy, but you're a legend. So please, make this interesting for me, duh?"
Now knowing Nikolai is trying to kill him, Hunk activates his cloak and begins slowly moving forward as to not give away his position. Spotting the window Nikolai is waiting in, he takes aim, and just before his cloak runs out, he opens fire, forcing Nikolai down as he again dives for cover. The Russian is mostly unharmed save for a bullet that grazes his ear.
"Cheap trick. But if that's how you're going to play, then so be it."
Taking aim once again, Nikolai watches the area Hunk decloaked and waits for Hunk to make his move. However, the USS agent is fine with simply spending the 2 minutes waiting, not moving a muscle, causing Nikolai to grow impatient and firing at any area where Hunk could be taking cover, but ultimately fails to hit Hunk. Eventually, Hunk's cloak reactivates, alerting Nikolai to his position. Fires a reactionary shot, missing Hunk, and tries to hit him with the rest of his magazine, but is unsuccessful. And Hunk once again fires up on his position, this time one of his bolts hitting Nikolai's vest. Nikolai knows that if this keeps up, it will only be a matter of time until Hunk will be close enough to either use more than suppressive fire, and from then on, it will be even sooner that Hunk will be able to be in the same building. So he calms himself down and starts to pay more attention, watching closely, and after two more cycles of Hunk's cloak, he has a good idea of how long it will last and how long it will take to recharge. However, from how fast Hunk is moving, he only has two more until he'll be close enough to make a dash for the door. Nikolai again waits for Hunk to reveal his position, moving just in time not to get shot, and having a very small amount of time, retreats back into the building, setting up his mines. Returning to his sniper post, Nikolai pulls out one of his grenades and throws it down to Hunk's position, catching the USS agent off guard and forcing him to run out before his cloak is recharged. Nikolai immediately takes the shot, hitting Hunk in the arm before he makes it to his new cover. Counting down the remaining seconds, Nikolai throws a second grenade just as Hunk activates his cloak, again turning to see the grenade rolling to him. He dives out of the way but is still partially caught in the blast and blown on his back. While most of the damage is superficial, Hunk is feeling all of it and decides to change up his tactics, firing small bursts up at Nikolai's position, keeping the man from aiming down at him while he sprints into the building. Nikolai drops his rifle to the ground and pulls out his sidearm, beginning to sneak around, still counting down the seconds before Hunk's cloak will reactivate. Hunk makes his way up to Nikolai's floor when shots are fired at him from a doorway, forcing him to turn the corner into a nearby room. Hunk tries to buy time for his cloak and asks Nikolai why he'd betray Umbrella. Nikolai responds by telling Hunk that he's just a mercenary and that he wasn't going to let Umbrella drag him down after the Raccoon City incident. As he says this, however, he pulls out a switch and activates the landmines which are currently in the room he had forced Hunk into. Hunk would undoubtedly notice this and run out of the room, firing his machine gun at full auto as to not let Nikolai get in a preemptive shot off on him. However, his clip runs dry as the mine explodes, making him stumble, and as he does, Nikolai turns the corner and rushing Hunk while firing his own gun with one of the bullets hitting Hunk's helmet, dazing him. As Nikolai gets closer, he disarms Hunk of his submachine gun and tries to kill Hunk once and for all, but the Grim Reaper recovers and the two begin to struggle over the pistol, but it becomes clear to Nikolai that Hunk is getting the better of him and he discharges the entire clip and lets Hunk take it. As this happens, Hunk sees an opening and uses one of his hidden arm blades to stab Nikolai, who manages to shift himself, only getting stabbed the shoulder. Nikolai kicks Hunk in the chest, sending them both to the ground, and Hunk grabs his handgun, firing and hitting Nikolai in the leg, before the Russian retreats into another room. Hunk quickly recovers and regains his submachine gun and reloads it before activating his cloak and following Nikolai's blood trail. As Hunk stalks through the room, he comes to the end of the trail at a closet door and fires into it. Cautiously opening the door, he finds nothing except for clothes. Then that Nikolai jumps on Hunk from behind, putting him in a chokehold. Hunk is again forced to just drop his gun, grabbing at Nikolai's grip and slamming his head back, breaking Nikolai's nose. But the Russian just keeps tightening his grip. Hunk backs up, smashing Nikolai into a wall repeatedly while also slamming his elbow into his ribs, eventually forcing Nikolai to let go. But as he does, he makes another grab for Hunk's pistol. Nikolai barely gets off a shot before Hunk twists his arm, making him drop the weapon. The two disengage just long enough for the two to pull out their knives. Both men are cautious, slowly inching closer before simultaneously going in for the kill. They are relatively even at first, with both men managing to land small cuts on the other, but as they go back and forth, it's becoming more and more clear that Hunk has the advantage here. Seeing this, he starts getting more and more aggressive, eventually managing to stab Nikolai in the gut and throw him to the ground. Hunk takes a moment to breathe before going to retrieve his handgun. However, as he does, a frag grenade rolls in front of him, and he turns to see Nikolai already halfway through the window before making a run for it, but ultimately getting caught in the blast and thrown out into the dirt. Even with the broken ribs and shrapnel embedded into his back, he manages to crawl towards his gun. Just as he reaches it, Nikolai stomps down on Hunk's arm and rips it from his grasp before firing the entire magazine into Hunk, finally killing him. And with that, I declare Nikolai Ginoviev, the Silver Fox, the winner. Well, this is another fight that surprised me, as I went into this fully expecting Hunk to win. But when all was said and done, Nikolai just has better chances of winning. While Hunk would likely win 9 out of 10 times in just a close range fight, or even the majority of time in a game of cat and mouse, when you take the initial encounter into play, if not getting outright killed, Hunk is going to take some serious damage before it comes down to these parts of the fight, and by then, Nikolai will have already come up with a counter to Hunk's biggest advantage, the cloak. What this fight ultimately came down to for me was Nikolai's more extensive training, better combat strategy, and better durability. While Hunk is overall stronger, Nikolai's durability would allow him to keep in the fight longer and let him pull off more riskier techniques if needed. While Hunk's cloak would be more than enough to secure the kill in an initial engagement, the rate he's going to need to use it just to get in close to Nikolai is going to give the UBCS soldier more than enough time to test and come up with a counter to it. Not to mention, thanks to his combat strategy as a sniper, putting so much distance in between the two would give Nikolai more than enough time to fortify his position and set up traps in case the fight did get to the point of a close range encounter. But that's just my opinion. What do you guys think? Do you agree with me that Nikolai would be able to put down Mr. Death? Or do you think that Hunk's cloak would let him kill the supervisor before he even knew what was happening? Let me know in the comments down below, and if I got anything wrong, please feel free to correct me. Also, before I go, I'd like to once again give a shout out to the YouTuber 3ToppingsGamer, whose Versus series was the inspiration for me starting my own. So if you like my content, please go check him out, as he has been at this for much longer and is, in my opinion, much better. Alright, with all that out of the way, please rate, comments, and subscribe. Go to my Twitter if you care about that, and I will see you guys next time.
So, what'll you do with your share of the gold we take from Governor Torres? Return to Africa, prince among men.
I cannot return to a place I've never been. I was born in Trinidad, a slave from my first breath.
Ah. Wouldn't you feel, I don't know, more welcome there?
As you might feel more welcome in Paris.
Fair point.
With this skin and this voice, where can I go in the world and feel at ease? This country here is my best chance. This country called Jackdaw, where I know the names of all citizens and they know mine, and we work together. Not always out of love, but to keep our country afloat.
I understand you. Let's take her then.
for the citizens of Jackdaw.
Do you swear to uphold the principles of our order? And all that for which we stand?
I do.
And never to share our secrets, nor divulge the true nature of our work?
I do.
And to do so from now until death, whatever the cost?
I do.
Then we welcome you into our fold, brother. You are now a Templar, harbinger of a new world. May the Father of Understanding guide us.
May the Father of Understanding guide us.